I was wondering about like clothing in regards to either Texas winning or disguising.
So clothing could be used in order to hide. It's the let me put it this way. For example, if a woman is wearing kind of a big belt skirt, right? She could be moving her feet in a way that don't give away. For example, if she was standing like this, underneath that skirt, you'd never know. And she could be launched for, you know, flashe, long attack, run, whatever you want to do. Clothing can be used for that, but generally speaking, it's not going to have much of an impact on whether or not the tell is seen by your opponent. Because it's the body's movement that triggers your opponent's defenses. Your opponent will not trigger until such time as this moves. So this tells them nothing. It gives away nothing. And the action is done so quickly. The neurons in the brain fire at around 250 miles per hour. Now, under normal circumstances, with driving, walking, holding a conversation while you're riding a bike, that is plenty fast enough. However, it is not fast enough to get through the three phases of see, process, and respond when you are not given anything other than here comes the attack. Which is why, and we'll get into this later, we'll be talking about something else that I do in order to give you that time. But if you don't give that to them, then you haven't increased the time for them, right? So a couple of times now, in a couple of different places, people have described me literally as a thief of time. Because I emphasize how much I will take time from my opponent so I can use it for my own good, and I will give nothing back to them. Now, whatever it is that you're doing, if you had more time to do something than somebody else does that not give you an advantage? Absolutely it does. And remember that, because we're going to talk about something in a little bit that's going to be key to that very concept right there. Okay? So, like I said, a lot of this stuff is going to be mid-level type of knowledge. So, again, if you don't understand something, I'm more than happy to explain. But, this is, again, for the purposes of being able to take what you already know and to help you augment that and make it just a little bit sharper. Okay? So, that there is talking about tell. That can be applied in a great many different directions. Okay? It's not just about the mind. My sword is not in my hand, how can you possibly know that? Because my body is telling me. to do what I'm about to do. If I have tells, this is where it comes from. I'm not going to look at your feet to see if you move. I'm going to use that to gauge how far away you are, because now I missed everything happening up here. And you probably just don't move something to the top of my head. You want to watch the body. This is what's going to give you all the information you need to be able to know what that person's going to do a split second before they do it. Fencing is measured in fractions of a second. If you are even one fraction of a second ahead of your opponent, the advantage is yours. Okay? We're not talking seconds here. Every second can be split down to about four time segments within a second. Okay? And I do not exaggerate. Okay, so, are there any questions on that? If not, I'm going to move on to the next topic. Okay? So, people ask me about the way that I hold my dagger, because it tends not to be the same every time. Nor should it, because every time I step out there with somebody, that is a different person. There is not one key for all locks. I know we use the whole, well, what about master keys? No, master keys. I'm not walking around with a master key and I'm not going to open up every single thing out there. It's not happening. People are the same way. Every time you step out there with somebody, that person and you create a whole new set of rules. Some of them are going to work, some of them don't work. It's the rules that work that determine this world you just created. Okay? So, for example, I fence according to what I call the adaptive dagger concept. Adaptive dagger means that I am going to limit the amount of time you have by locking out the shortest route possible to my body. Borrow you. Grab your sword and dagger to have it on hand, whatever you like. Don't need your mask, I promise I'll catch you. That hasn't happened in at least a
year. Is invisible. Where's my sword right now? Where is your view?
Yeah, it is, right? Okay. Oh, yeah. Yeah, I'm crossing my real sword, exactly. But my sword is invisible. How do you know? Because my body is telling me. Do you watch that? Get used to seeing it right here. just telling you like I did, right? Now watch. Let's say, and I haven't run into a lot of these people that are outside of my own school, but let's say he's a Wilbur fighter. He's a guy that fights in this position here, right? Again. Watch my dagger. Here's my unguarded sentence. I just cut off this straight line shot to him. If he wants to do anything different, he has to. That's more time in my favor. There's a little bit more of an advanced concept to this now. That's the basic stuff. That is just, he goes into an unguarded stance, and I line it up such that he has to take the longer path. But watch what happens when I defend myself. Watch what this does. Lunge. Do you see my dagger? Now why is it down there? That's not where his sword is. Why is my dagger down there?
That's where he's going next.
Because if he was to come off my sword right now, where is he going to go? That's where he has to go. My adaptive dagger cut off the only path he had possible. So now, since I get to here, I have cut off every avenue he has, and he has to take a really long path now if he wants to get free. That is a long path. But guess what my sword is doing while he's taking that long path? Yeah, well, I'm taking a focus on things about this, so we're going to take the attack. So, the adaptive dagger is not something, the dagger itself is not something you should keep static. I understand that sounds a little basic and obvious, but I'm telling you, if you go out there and you face 10 people, the vast majority that you face out there, that's exactly what the dagger is doing. Regardless of who they're facing, the dagger looks exactly the same when they step out every single time. Right? My opponent is a low guard swordsman. You know, and you see my dagger is up high? That's probably a trap. But honestly, this is probably me trying to lure you into something. But that's because I got 33 years back in government. You know, my skill set. But if you've got a high guard swordsman and I come up there and shoot him like this, and I got a middle guard swordsman that comes out there and I meet him like this. I got a low guard swordsman, maybe them like this. That is because you have gotten into a pattern that you think one size fits all. And right, but that is not how it works, right? Remember the Princess Bride fight, right? Oh, you're using Benigni's defense against me. Oh, I thought if it ain't concerning about the terrain, I'm gonna use Captain Pharaoh. Well, if I find that, because they were naming things that they supposedly countered what the other person was doing. And there's always a counter to the counter, and a counter to a counter to the counter, right? That's fencing. But if you are static, you know, you're going to plateau, and you're going to get to that plateau, and that's exactly where you're going to be. I would want to help you improve that. None of what I just discussed there is antithetical, but whatever style you may or may find is your preferred. I don't care if you're talking Fabris, I don't care if you're talking Captain Pharaoh, Satin Yellow, Silver. Whatever, insert your mastery of your favorite gear. None of that is antithetical to your being able to improve your ability to fence against whoever. Right? We are all different, unique people. We're going to bring different strengths and weaknesses, speeds and reflexes, how we move, how many tells we have or don't have. You, as a fencer, to be the surviving person, you have to adapt to what that person is presenting. Because the way I engage him is going to be different than the way I engage him, the way I'm going to engage you, or anybody else for that matter. But if you don't, if you always come out there with the exact same thing, you know, you're limited. Let's just put it that way. Okay? Are there any questions to that? So, what I'm going to do now, and we're going to do this very slowly. You don't need to have a mask, but if you want to have one, by all means. But what I'm going to have you do, we're going to pair up again. Grab your sword, and does everybody have a dagger or no? Everyone does?
No.
Cool. All right. What we're going to do is we're going to go through a couple of simple, common placements of that dagger when you are receiving your opponent's attack. And then I'm going to teach you a couple of things about the adaptive dagger in the offensive capacity, right? Because let's face it, nobody here wants to die in a very period fashion where both guys are ventilating each other and we both end up bleeding on the field together, which I'm telling you, was a very common way to die back in the day. Both people were so intent on hitting the other person, there was no thought whatsoever of defending themselves while they're doing that. Okay, that's great if all you want to do is come away with a really neat scar at best. Preferably, we would take a hard count, right? So, like, grab your sword, grab the dagger, move forward.